public and private sectors. But we are meeting with a proud Sri Lankan today that who has achieved highest level of quality and efficiency. Mr. Rohan Pallivatta, Executive Chairman of Lankahans.
Last year, he was the first ever to receive the PIMA Diamond Award at the PIMA inaugural Olympics. And he recently got the opportunity to speak at the United Nations head office in New York. So good morning, Mr. Pallivatta. Thank you so much for sparing us and giving up your valuable time. So without wasting any more of that time, we will first get on to the very first question. Mr. Pallivatta, the greatest phenomenon behind your name is the achievement of the 1 ppm quality, which big players like China and India also failed to achieve. Can you tell us a little bit about how you were able to achieve that and the success behind it?
Well, as you rightly said, the uniqueness of the product that I do is its quality requirement, which is 1 ppm quality, and which means only a single defect would be tolerated for a million produced. And once again, the uniqueness is, this is the first time that Sri Lanka has entered the international market with a 1 ppm quality product. And the reason that there is such stringent quality, because that is the highest level of quality anywhere in the world. And the reason that there is such quality is the device that I manufacture here will decide the difference between life and death. Because if this particular device fails, it might end up in death. So that is why this quality requirement is there. And in achieving this with the Sri Lankan workers, that was in fact a challenge. Because especially not the challenge with the workers itself, but the thinking of the Sri Lankans, that we are not in a class where we can achieve that level of quality in this country with the existing work ethic of this country. But as I always say, looking at all the great monuments built by our ancestors and the precision work that they had undertaken almost 2000 years ago, I was convinced that Sri Lankans has this DNA of quality, and it was my role to provide the right leadership and rekindle the DNA that is in them already to bring about this quality in them. So that is how I'm here today.
You answered several of our questions all at once, but when we got here, we saw outside there were so many enthusiastic employees, and even at the entrance we were greeted with a smile and we were directed here with a smile. So how do you mold these employees and how do you develop them?
Well, as I told you, one thing is the Japanese program that we have here, and when you have a majority culture, the new people who are recruited will naturally get absorbed in that majority culture. So it is mostly the Japanese culture that is prevalent here, that is being introduced through me. And once I get to go to Japan and when they, you know, go through the training, even the speed that they walk changes once they come. Yes, now regarding especially the Japanese, when you do business with the Japanese, it is very important that you visit them frequently. So therefore, even now, I go to Japan at least 6 times a year. Right? But not for any formal meetings as such, but just to keep the relationship. You might have to play golf with them, go out fishing with them, and do things that they like to keep the relationship. Right? Because in Japan, relationship comes first. But with the European countries, of course, faxes, emails, that can still keep the relationship intact. But then in any business, as you know, the inner play matters. Right? What is seen on the surface is not the real play. That is what any business will have, what is called the inner play. So you have to have a relationship with the key figures of your business who will be making decisions on behalf of you, decisions that will be affecting your organization. So those relationships matter, and you have to be very mindful as to how you should keep these relationships intact. For example, if a purchasing manager in Europe wants to come to a holiday in Sri Lanka, of course, I should be footing all his bills, right? Because keep the relationship, that's very important. So these are not in the books, but these are personally one of the things that you have to think of an opportunity. So sometimes they might be that they do not have any contact in Sri Lanka, somebody from Romania or some from Belgium, countries that I'm supplying, might contact me and ask, you know, can you suggest some good hotels, right? So then I should go out of my way. All right, I will suggest. And to their surprise, well, once they are here, I will of course settle their bills as well. Right? But that is to keep the relationship. So this kind of thing is very important.
So, Ms. Bharat, it's fair to say that you are a business tycoon in Sri Lanka. So, considered to be a business tycoon in Sri Lanka. So, how do you manage to stay on top of the game with so many other competitors and businesses thriving in Sri Lanka nowadays?
Well, lucky for me, I'm in a virtual, although there are other businesses. When it comes to my particular business and my particular industry, I'm in a virtual blue ocean because I do not have any competitors in Sri Lanka or in the region for that matter. So therefore, I'm enjoying this, but that does not necessarily mean that there cannot be another player tomorrow. I'm very mindful of that. But only thing is, when it comes to a product like this, a product that decides life and death, the existing people who place orders, right, for this product will not take a chance by trying it with a new supplier. It takes long time. I have been in this for the past 14 years. And it takes a long time to establish your credentials. Right? So once your credentials are established, right, then it's smooth sailing. For example, I started by supplying only to Toyota. But today I'm supplying not only to Toyota, all the brands in Japan, Nissan, Honda, Mitsubishi, Mazda, all of them. And in Europe, Volvo, Saab, BMW, Aston Martin. And in USA, General Motors, Ford, Chrysler. All these came not through my own marketing, but through referrals from one company to another.
So we have a bit of a different question now. We all know that you are a great speaker, but then we also know that even great speakers do get nervous. So what do you do to calm your nerves when you go out there and give a speech?
Yeah, I have to admit, even though I may have delivered 1,000 keynotes, and when I have to go and deliver the 1,001st keynote, I will still be nervous. That is a fact. But over the years, that confidence has been building in me. But the first few minutes, first few seconds, of course I will be nervous. But then one of the reasons that as of recent I have been starting most of my presentations by singing a song. And when you are nervous, the most difficult thing is to sing. You can speak, because to sing, you have to keep your pitch, and you have to keep the lyrics and everything intact. When you are nervous, sometimes you don't get your voice. There is, you feel a lump in your throat kind of thing. So I have done that to challenge myself, actually, if I can sing. But at least on the first two, three occasions when I tried to sing, voice did not come. But now I have practiced it so much. And by the end of the song, I'm settled. The most of the audiences, in 100% cases, at the end of the song, they would, clap. There would be an applause. The moment that applause comes from the audience, I'm settled.
You are chairman of one of the fastest growing companies in the world, Sri Lanka. And you travel all over the world. In fact, you just came on Monday from Japan. How do you manage work-life balance with all this hectic schedule?
Well, I think that is very Western rooted, oriented question coming from the West. But we in Asia, I do not see work as completely different, because even when I come from home to my office, I'm thinking of this place as an extension of my home, right? So most of the utensils that I have at home, I have here in my office as well, because if I have to stay overnight, I still can stay overnight. So I feel it is an extension of my home. And I have one daughter, and when I go home, I inquire about school activities, right? So I have time for family. I have no complaints. I don't know why people, maybe when you get into the level of chairman, Coca-Cola, you might still have, but still I don't believe that. The moment you go up, I think you will have more time if you really manage. If you are, no point being successful. If the equation of success equals high blood pressure, diabetes, plus, then why should you achieve that kind of success? Right? You have to be healthy. I mean, of course, one day we will succumb to some illness, but then you have to be healthy as long as you can.
So another question that we wanted to ask you was, we all know who you are today, and we and the Peace College Candy, and you were the head prefect there, and we also know that you like martial arts. That's where it stops. So we would like to know a bit more about you, how you were as a child, what you were like a boy. So.
Well, until grade 10, of course, when I started my martial arts when I was around in grade 8, right? And I still do about 100 knuckle push-ups every day.
You can see that.
So, I think martial arts helped a lot to develop personality within you. Because as a grade 8 student, at that time, you know, might is right? Whoever who can, fight, and then he becomes the leader of the class. So none of the students at my age, at that grade 8 level, were pursuing martial arts. So therefore, naturally, I became the leader of the class. And then by grade 10, of course, after my O-levels, I received a scholarship to go to Japan. The reason that I selected Japan was because of my love for martial arts. And then I pursued martial arts in Japan as well. So when I came back to Sri Lanka with 2 black belts, one for judo and one for karate. And then after a year, I was appointed head prefect of my school. I still remember the day that I came to the assembly from Japan. I had the 2 black belts and the trophies that I won in Japan. And they were kept on the stage on the Monday assembly. And our, St. Anthony's College, the principal is a father, a Catholic priest. And he was telling Mr. Pallavatheska, return to Sri Lanka with 2 black belts. And I'm warning him, don't try anything with me, because I have a bigger black belt. He was telling me. When I became head prefect, I went to classes and spoke to them. I had very good communication. And I told them, if you try to make too much noise, people will be disturbed. So why not, read something and do something. And then during my year, after about 6 months, when parents came to my school, they were asking the principal whether it's a holiday here at St. Anthony's, because it was almost sealed, noise was gone. And that was not done through inflicting fear, but then by that time I have won the respect of the people, and that is what is important. Even in running an organization, I mean, you can do it military style to a certain extent, but you can't sustain it. In the military you can, because they will lose their employment address, but in an organization like this, people are free. You cannot have a military style for long. So you have to win that respect.
You mentioned that you are actually a global professional, and you have an English degree as well, and an MBA as well. So if you hadn't started the business, would you just continue on in your profession? Could you be looking for somewhere else to start another profession?
Because now I started as an attorney at law, and there was this cognitive dissonance. I think you have learned this word, right? Cognitive dissonance, where my heart could not agree with my mind. Because when I was practicing, I was wondering, now every day when I charge a fee, I mean, when you're doing a profession, you can't do it free of charge, but that becomes your bread and butter. So now, when I was charging my clients, I knew most of these clients were much poorer than I. And I know that it was very difficult for them to pay my fee. And I was taking the money out of a pocket from another Sri Lankan. I was wondering, what is my contribution to the Sri Lankan economy, genuinely, right? So this kept bothering me. Am I to continue my whole life, doing this kind of thing? Nothing, adding nothing to the, no value to our economy? So this question was always there. So I do not think I would have settled as a lawyer, because this feeling was disturbing me. So I would have started something else on my own. I do not know what.
Actually, you talked about a little bit about your days at school, days at St. Anthony's College. Was there any particular person in your family or like professional that you consider to be your hero, that had some influence in you, the way you have become?
Well, my greatest influence was my father. And coincidentally, today, my father is not in the land of living, but had he been in the land of living, today is his birthday, and he would have been 74 years today. And he was my greatest influence. Because he was a person who had knowledge in electronics. And he was an ex-Air Force officer. And so his knowledge inspired me a lot. And even when we graduated from the transistor radio, bare radios to transistors, and then from ICs, then to semiconductors, and so on, and then to computers, right? His knowledge still was intact. Of course, he was getting down all the new magazines from UK, and he was a bit reader of all the new technology changes that was taking place in the world. And I was surprised because when he could even handle a computer, he could repair a computer. I was one day amazed, and I asked him, "How do you do this?" And the other thing that amazed me was, Air Force had a problem with their coffee jets, with the computer system, radar system. And then they summoned someone who knew my father. We brought in the engineers from UK, from some other countries. They summoned my father to see whether he could fix it. He took about 3 days, right? And I also went there with him, and I saw, you know, the boards of the coffee was like, you know, it was like it has been blasted. I was wondering what the hell is he doing, right? But within 3 days, everything was fixed, everything was okay. They did not have to summon the engineers from overseas. And this was perfectly in running condition. So I asked him, "How do you do this? Because this is not what you learned. This is something totally different." But the answer he gave me, he said, "Things may change, but the fundamentals of science are the same." Right? So if you know your fundamentals, even the product is new, right? You can still repair it if you use your fundamentals.
This kind of thing that, you know, your father working on a cafe, and then you are like doing, trying to fix the samples, and I send it to Japan, I can think similarities.
Yes, subconsciously, maybe he had definitely had an influence in me when reflecting back. Although I did not get involved in what he was doing.
So, Swadhartha, you have come a long way in such a short time, and you have come to a place where you are established. I mean, so what is next for you? Where do you see yourself maybe, like in the future? Where do you have to go next?
I think I should ask him this question for myself. I think 2-3 years, even my critics, my friends who are my critics, they said, what have you done during the past 5 years? All right, you have come out with a big company, but you have been saying the same story now. Now you have to, you know, you can't be saying that your turnover is $40 million after 10 years' time. Right? You have to say it's much more than that. But of course, I will tell you, if you take the growth, year on year, it has been more than 10%.
Sometimes, like, I think we were talking about making Sri Lanka the one of Asia.
Yeah.
You talked about our ancestors and then what they have done, what we can take out of that. We would want Sri Lanka to be one of the top countries in the world. How do you think we can get there?
Well, I think I might talk about a little about politics in that case. Because now the main obstacle is the political system that we have. Now you see, if you have to get an approval, and if you submit to the, you know, if it has to go through the parliamentary procedure, it has to go through the cabinet, right? And the investors wouldn't wait. All the big investments, such as Shangri-La, which came to Sri Lanka during the previous regime, they came in an unsolicited way. No tenders were called, right? And I know, personally, Mr. Vasil Rajapaksa was met by the owner of Shangri-La, president of Shangri-La. Just one day he came in his private jet, met, signed the agreement, left. Right? He will not stay here for weeks and weeks until this guy approves, that guy approves. So big deals does not happen then. And they don't have the time for that. And even the land there in front of Goldfields was subsequently allocated, you know, but it was passed through the parliament subsequently. Right. So one thing, the politics, of course people might say democracy is good, but then for a country like us, I think democracy is killing us, right? Because if you try to listen to all the opinions, I don't think we will get anywhere.
Finally, you have a lot from your past experience and knowledge.
personally as well as professional any tips that we can get?
Yeah, one thing is, I think many a people should think of starting on their own. Because if every person thinks of getting employed in an existing blue chip company, where would be the generation? Where is the generation that would create these kind of enterprises for the next generation to get employed? Right, the population is growing, so we need more and more enterprises. And therefore, the first thought that you want to start something on your own is very important. And it can be while being employed at Demos or any other company for that matter. Right? You can try your thing in a small way. Right? But the only thing is you have to give a lot of thinking. And the technology can come in. Right? Because most of the companies that were successful had some breakthrough technology. Right? So the future, I think there will be a mix of technologies like nanotechnology and biotech. Right? There will be new names coming up. Right? And if you can write that way, because our Sri Lanka, we are talking about assembling motor vehicles here.
Yes.
But I think it's an obsolete industry because most of the people, they have graduated and they have done it for decades and decades. Right? Unless we do, of course, our requirement of the country, that's a different matter. But in a commercial scale, if we are to do vehicles, I don't think it's better to ride a different wave. So that wave has taken place many decades ago. And the margins will not be very high, even if we achieve that. So we have to think of something new.